The MAX7219 integrated circuit uses multiplexing to drive up to 64 individual LEDs. And in this tutorial, I will show you how the MAX7219 works, what multiplexing is, and how you can use popular MAX7219 based modules to drive 7-segment displays and LED dot matrix displays with a PIC microcontroller.
Hi, my name is Jens, and I believe that everybody can learn electronics, and this channel here is all about beginner-friendly electronics tutorials with and without microcontrollers. And if you want to follow along today's tutorial, then here's what you need.
A 400-pin breadboard, a 4.5-volt AA battery compartment, and of course also the batteries, the PIC16F1455 microcontroller, a push button, an LED with a 220 ohms resistor, a 100 microfarad capacitor, and a 100 nanofarad capacitor. And then of course you also need one or more of these MAX7219 based LED modules, like this 7-segment module here or this dot matrix module. I have a detailed list with links to all of these components for you in the companion article on friendlywire.com, the link is in the description.
So what is multiplexing? In the days of 60Hz GIFs and 240Hz gaming monitors, we sometimes forget that our eyes are actually quite slow, but multiplexing makes a really clever use of this.
Say you want to control 64 LEDs. For direct drive, we would need 64 wires. But if we connect them in groups of 8 with their anodes and cathodes shared like this, we only need 16 wires instead of 64. The price that we have to pay for this is that we cannot control all LEDs at the same time. Say we want to display a smiley face like this. We can generate each row of this image by connecting the cathodes of that row to ground and by sending VDD to the LEDs that should be on. But here is the trick. If we do that fast enough, around 1000 times per second, and that is called the multiplexing frequency, our eyes don't notice this flickering anymore and it looks like all LEDs are on at the same time. This is called persistence of vision, and it is the reason that multiplexing works.
Now the MAX7219 is an LED multiplexer that takes care of all that switching for us automatically. So now let's have a look at how to connect this integrated circuit to control 64 LEDs at a time.
And here it is, the MAX7219 integrated circuit. It has 24 pins in total. There are 8 outputs where you connect the anodes of the 8 LED rows, and another 8 outputs where you connect the 8 cathodes. With a resistor from ISET to VDD, you can set the LED current, and there is a nice table in the datasheet that shows you how to select the resistor value based on the LED current and its color. VDD is plus 5 volt and connected at pin 19, and there are 2 ground connections at pins 4 and 9. It is also a good idea to place a 100 nanofarad bypass capacitor close to the chip. The MAX7219 has 3 inputs, data in, clock, and load. They are used to tell the MAX7219 what to display, and more on that in just a second. The MAX7219 also has an output called data out, which allows you to connect multiple of these chips in a row. Connect data out to data in of the next chip and so on. In that case, the load and clock lines all have to be connected in parallel. The two MAX7219 based display modules that we saw at the beginning of this video are basically a combination of all of these components. The dot matrix display actually has 4 groups of 64 LEDs, each with their own MAX7219 driver chip. And later in this video, when we drive such a module with our PIC controller, I will use this symbol here for the dot matrix module to save some space. Now what about the 7-segment module? The main idea is that the 8 LEDs in every column that the MAX7219 can drive can be thought of as the 8 LEDs inside of a common cathode 7-segment display, and here is the schematic. And later in this video, I will use this symbol here again to save some space. And if you need more display real estate, you can of course chain both of these types of modules together, or even combinations of them.
So how do we talk to the MAX7219? The nice thing is that we don't have to worry about the multiplexing timing at all because the chip does that for us automatically. So what it boils down to is us sending out commands to the chip like turn on this LED or turn off the entire display. But how do we do that?
On the inside, the MAX7219 has 13 registers that can each store 8 bits. So controlling the MAX7219 means that we have to send data to these registers. Now each command is made up of 8 bits that carry the address of the register we want to write to, and then 8 data bits that we want to write to that register. We need to send them out in this sequence here, using the 3 wires data, clock, and load. The MAX7219 reads the data line at each rising edge on the clock input. during all of that, the load line needs to be low, and only after all 16 bits have been sent, we can pulse it briefly from low to high and then back to low again. This loads the data we just sent into the specific register of the MAX7219.
And maybe you notice, this is exactly how you would send data to a 16-bit wide shift register. And if you want to learn more about shift registers, we have a video for you right here. Now let's go through the most important commands to get you started.
To turn the MAX7219 on, you need to send a 1 to register number 12, and the total command looks like this in binary. Each group of 8 LEDs has a register of their own, so by sending a byte to these 8 registers at address 1 to 8, we can control all 64 LEDs, and we will see how that works in a lot of detail later. The brightness of the display can be regulated in 16 steps, and all we need to do is send a number between 0 and 15 to register number 10. And to turn the display off again, we need to send a 0 to register 12.
So for the rest of this video, let's try to get all of this to work on a PIC microcontroller.
This here is our simple test circuit, and the MAX7219 display module can be plugged in here later. The PIC16F1455 controls the data, clock, and load input of the module, and the push button and the LED are only here for testing purposes. The capacitors C1 and C2 are added for stability, and the battery G1 here supplies the circuit with 4.5 volts. This is just for testing. In a real application, it would be a better idea to use a dedicated power supply instead, because the LEDs will drain the batteries really quickly.
So let's first build the circuit and then, in a second step, plug in our MAX7219-based LED modules to make sure that it all really works.
Place the 400-pin breadboard in front of you and make sure row 1 is at the top. Insert the PIC16F1455 in row 4 and connect it to power at pins 1 and 14. Insert the 100 microfarad bulk capacitor in the power rail and then insert the 100 nanofarad bypass capacitor as well. Insert the push button between rows 3 and 5 and connect row 3 to ground. Then place the test LED in rows 10 and 11 with the cathode connecting to the ground rail via the 220 ohms resistor. Connect the data, load, and clock lines from pins 5, 6, and 7 down to rows 16, 17, and 18 on the breadboard. Insert two more wires for VDD and ground, and this way we can later plug in any MAX7219 based module we want right here on the breadboard because they all tend to have the same pinout. Here you can see that pinout for the 7-segment module, and this is the dot matrix display. Back on the breadboard, connect both power rails on either side like this, and finally connect the 4.5 volt battery pack to the power rail. And last, wire up the PIC-Kit 3 to the PIC16F1455 like this. Here is the complete schematic, and here is how it looks like in real life. Then plug the PIC-Kit 3's USB end into your computer. Start the MPLAB IDE and create a new project for the PIC16F1455. Add an empty main.c source file and finally open the MPLAB IPE to establish a connection between the PIC16F1455 and the PIC-Kit 3.
If this was a little bit too fast, then don't worry about it. I have a very detailed video on how to set up the MPLAB IDE, the IPE, how to connect the PIC-Kit 3 to your controller, and how to flash a hex file onto the controller as well. And you can check that video out right here. But for now, let's see how this looks like in real life, and let's look at the 7-segment display modules first.
Connect one of the 7-segment display modules to the circuit, and the way that we place the wires on the breadboard, make sure that the module should plug right in. And this is how it looks like in the schematic. Next, copy and paste the 7-segment source code from the companion article on Friendly Wire. Compile the code and flash the hex file onto the PIC16F1455. Here is what appears on the 7-segment display, and you can press the button to cycle through the 16 different LED brightness levels. Back in the source code, this is the part that adjusts the LED brightness. If you are interested, there will be a detailed explanation of the complete source code in a dedicated program guide video that should be out in a few days from now. So in this video here, we are only covering the main idea. So in that spirit, let's focus on that part of the code that sends out the display pattern to the 7-segment displays. The command MAX7219send sends out 8 bits of data to a given address inside the MAX7219 using the protocol we talked about earlier. And MAX7219update pulses the load line to update the data. These numbers here are the addresses, and they go from 1 to 8, where 1 is the display on the very right and 8 is the display on the very left. These 8 bits here correspond to the 7 segments and the decimal point of each display. Here are some examples of different code with a corresponding output on the display. And last, remember that you can always add additional displays as well. This is how it looks like in the schematic. Only then, for each new display, you also have to send out an additional command before pulsing the load line, because the data has to be passed down to the last display in the line. For example, this is how the code looks like for two displays, and remember that you also have to send out multiple commands for each display during the initial configuration of the MAX7219 modules.
And now that we understand the seven segment modules, let's take a look at the dot matrix modules next, and you can actually see one behind me right there. So let's go.
For this part, we first disconnect the seven segment displays and instead connect a dot matrix module that internally has four MAX7219 chips chained together with 256 LEDs in total. And this is how the corresponding schematic looks like. First, again go to the companion article on FriendlyWire and copy the dot matrix source code and paste it inside the MPLAB IDE. Compile the code and flash the hex file onto the PIC, and this is what you should see. And just as before, you can use the button to cycle through the different LED brightness levels. When looking at the code that sends out the display pattern, you see that it is kind of similar to that of the two chain 7-segment displays from before. What is sent out first travels all the way through the chain of the four displays. So the last command, before the update command, sends data to the leftmost display in the chain. This time around, the register addresses 1 through 8 label the LED rows from bottom to top, and the 8 bits here correspond to the LEDs in each row. The least significant bit, that's this one right here, is the leftmost LED in each row, so it is kind of mirrored. And when you look at the code and then at the LEDs, with a little bit of imagination, you can actually see the LED pattern inside the code. Kinda makes you feel like Neo in the Matrix, doesn't it? And if you want, you can of course extend your source code to define some characters and even create an LED clock that way. And let me know if you want to see this as a future video.
I really like the idea of multiplexing LEDs because it doesn't take up a lot of space. You can do it with just three wires when you use these MAX7219 based LED modules, and they're really very small and very easy to drive once you get the main idea. But as always, there can be some sort of problems. Now when you look behind me, you see all kinds of things on my workbench. For example, you see my power supply and the bench meter that I have in my lab. Now when you look closely at these LEDs, you see that they flicker a little bit, and that's because they are multiplexed, just like this display up here. Now multiplexing happens at a very fast frequency, typically a couple thousand hertz. But I'm filming this on a DSLR right here, and that DSLR has a shutter speed, and that shutter speed may not be exactly aligned with the multiplexing frequency, which leads to these variations in brightness. So when I want to build something that is supposed to be the prop in a movie, or something like this in a scene that's going to sit when it's filmed with a DSLR, I'll always think twice before I use multiplexing, because you can run into this kind of problem that you have this flickering. You'll have to tune the shutter speed of your DSLR camera to get rid of this, but that's really one of the only drawbacks I can think of with multiplexing. I hope I could show you how easy it is to use these MAX7219 based LED modules, and I hope I could inspire you to use them in your own projects. And if you do, please share it with me on social media. I always love seeing your creations. Thank you so much for watching. Let me know what else you want to learn, and I will see you next time.